Hello everyone, welcome to the next module of virtual training. Today we will be talking about rubber dam and the technique to isolate single teeth. I would be introducing you to all the parts of a rubber dam kit, followed by the techniques that are usually very famous for using rubber dams. Today you will be learning how to isolate anterior teeth and posterior teeth, what all basic techniques are used, and I will try to make it very easy for you so that the entire process does not look cumbersome to you, and it will be very easy on a daily basis to do it. I assure you that once you have started using rubber dam, it will become very difficult in the initial phase, but as and when you practice more and more with every single endodontic case and restorative case, things will become very easy, and isolation of a single tooth, the time consuming part will reduce to around 1 minute or less than 1 minute. The only difficult part about using rubber dam is convincing a dentist to use rubber dams. Rubber dams have been in dentistry for over 100 years now. Let me introduce you to the basic parts of rubber dam. This is a clamp or a forceps for the clamps that we use in rubber dam. We have different clamps. We have wingless clamps and winged clamps. We have special clamps for anterior teeth and special clamps for pediatric teeth also, or for premolars. This is the rubber dam punch. It has got a small disc with multiple holes. The smallest hole is for lower anterior teeth. The middle ones are usually used for premolars and small pediatric teeth, or what we say deciduous teeth. The last two are usually in relation with the biggest kind of diameter a rubber dam punch should have, and for this they are apt for maxillary molars, mandibular molars and central incisors. You also need a plastic carrying instrument or a filling instrument. This is also used. The other parts are a plastic frame. In certain brands we get this stainless steel frames also. So most practitioners and mentors I have seen, they are using stainless steel frames for restorative purposes, and these plastic ones for endodontic purposes. The reason can be because this is radiolucent, so while you are taking intraoral radiographs of working length and master cones, there will be no superimposition of this frame, or the image will not be distorted by any hindrance. We will be using liquid dam also. We will teach you how to use it. We are using floss. This is very essential. You might need a light cueing unit and these simple clamps will be helpful. So let's discuss every clamp in detail and how to see which clamp is apt for different teeth. We will teach you some shortcuts also, and we will teach you what all kind of materials are used. The most important is learning about the sheets. The sheets of rubber dam. One more important part is this template. Different brands have different kind of templates. This is a fiber template, but some brands will also give you templates in papers or laminated plastic form sheets. So this is how a rubber dam sheet looks in most of the kits. This is a deep blue color. Multiple colors have been introduced in rubber dams. They can be from purple to pink, recently yellow color. Black color sheets are very, very popular, and mint green color sheets are also popular. So as you can see, there are two surfaces of this sheet. One is more reflective. This is more reflective, and this is less reflective, or we can say dull or matte finish. So every sheet has certain amount of matte finish to it on one side, and the other side is shiny or reflective. Let's learn more about these sheets. These sheets are 6x6 in size. Right now I am using an Indian made sheet. It is preferable to keep these sheets in cold temperature, preferably a refrigerator if you have, because a lot of heat, if provided to these sheets, it can cause tearing of these sheets. There is another very famous brand, Nicktone. This is also used by many dentists, and as we can see, the sheets are beautiful. These are beautiful sheets. The reflective area and the matte surface is clearly distinguishable. They are slightly heavy in, or what we say, medium heavy in their consistency. This is also 6x6 in size, and I'll show you how you can stretch them. The stretching capability is very high. See this, I'll do it again, and they don't tear apart. There is another brand that is frequently available with the dental dealers. It is Century. This kind of template has been provided by them so that we can mark the sheets very carefully. This is mint green in color. This is a very famous and peculiar color that is available with most of the brands. See the reflective surface and the matte surface. How beautiful it is. So let's start how to start marking these sheets, how to use them. Even before we start, I will tell you this is mint flavored. Can you see here? It's mint flavored, it's medium thickness, and it's green. So what all colors are available? Blue is also available. Thickness can be very thin or heavy. The heavy consistency is used mostly for restorative purposes, and it is very good in reflecting the gingiva, or it keeps the gingiva away from the restorative surface. And there is a small trick. In certain times when we are working very hard, and we usually forgot to order them again, or the rubber dam sheets are still in transit and you are not actually procuring them, or it is not available for a particular period of time, I have seen certain dentists have started using this gloves. So this is a nitrile glove. It will have a very less stretchability, but it will be latex free, and in certain patients where latex allergy has been seen, they can be used. or you can use your routine white colored latex gloves also, but that is not preferable. That is only a makeshift arrangement for the cases if you are run out of these sheets. But these sheets are ideal. This is 6x6 for pediatric patients. 5x5 sheets are available. The size of the frame will also reduce for pediatric patients. It will become a bit smaller and it is much more comfortable. There are certain brands that provide complete rubber dam cases, like it's a Unidam sort of a product where you do not need these frames. These frames are not required. They are already printed, and where you have to punch them, you know it. So let's start with the marking of the system. I will show you this. So this is the reflective surface and this is the matte surface. So reflective surface is always towards the tooth surface or gingiva, and this matte finish is towards the occlusal surface of the tooth. The purpose is, when you do photography for the cases, you do not need reflective surfaces. You need more matte surfaces or matte finish. Also, the reflective surface has an advantage to reflect the saliva and the gingival sulcus also. So let's start. If I am using this sheet, I need to orient myself, and I wish I do not make more mistakes every time I'm using this. So this is a orientation mark. Some practitioners make a small sign, like a small dot, or they write R. This represents the right side of your hand. So we can mark this way. If we are taking, let's take an example of lower mandibular teeth. We will do 4-6. This is 3-6. This will be the third quadrant and this is the first molar. So we will consider this as 3-6, and from here I will count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So this will become the third quadrant mark. Usually the diameter of these teeth, or diameter in the sense the periphery, is huge in size. Most molars are big in size. So let's make a small punch over it. I am using the second one in this case, the second one, and I just do not make one single hole. I make 1.5. So what I'll do is, I'll just precisely move it a bit down and I'll punch it again. So the entire size of this hole will become 1.5 times. Before you start your rubber dam, I must ask you to see if there is interdental space and there is proper space to move your rubber dam sheet. If you miss out on this step, what will happen? There are possibilities that your rubber dam might tear away or it doesn't reach between the teeth. So make sure there is enough space and there are no flaws. when we study about these clamps, certain times the practitioners become very confused and they do not know which clamp to use at which location. So let me simplify it for you. Let us learn the clamps. They are very easy to understand. You can see there are certain wings here. These are called winged clamps. And you can see here, there is no wing. So these are wingless clamps. Every practitioner has their own choice of using these clamps. For mostly restorative purposes, wingless clamps come very handy. For the areas of lower posterior teeth like wisdom tooth or third molar and maxillary teeth, where there can be limited mouth opening or anatomical obstructions, it is preferred to have a wingless clamp. They give a great compatibility towards the lower posterior teeth and maxillary molars also. When these kind of butterfly shaped clamps are seen, they are mostly for anterior teeth, and when you use them, you can see there is the size of these forks are very close and very similar. So this is for lower anteriors and maxillary lateral incisor. These can be used, but when you see there is a bigger area on this clamp, this is mostly used for the incisal surface of maxillary teeth, maxillary central incisors. It is very useful. There is a small trick: in case your clamp is not your fitting for the premolars, lower premolars, this clamp comes very handy and it can be used. Can you see something? These black colored are beautiful to document, and the matte finish of these clamps provide more photographic benefits and documentation benefits because they reflect less light. There is another variety, that is, you can see some teeth are there on these clamps. So these teeth are usually used for the maxillary molars. The bigger the surface, it is always towards the buccal side of the tooth. So if we see in maxillary molars, and the placement of this ring is always distal. So if we see, this is a larger surface and this is a smaller surface. So preferably this surface, the larger surface, and the band, it will be distal to it. So distal the tooth, if in case we are considering the first molar of second quadrant, the buccal surface is here and the larger area of the tooth will be of the tooth of the clamp will hold on this surface. The smaller teeth surface will hold on to the palatal surface. There is another quality that you should understand about clamps. If you see, this clamp has a flat wing, but this clamp has a moved wing. You can see there is a certain inclination to the prongs of this clamp. What happens is there can be partially destructed tooth, attrited tooth, or partially erupted teeth. So in that case, these kind of clamps are used, because these clamps go a bit deeper towards the gingiva and hold the teeth towards the cemento enamel junction or the deeper areas of the tooth. So these kind of clamps are preferred. So we have already learned about the clamps and the kind of sheets that we use in dentistry. I will be taking care of this first molar of third quadrant, and I have showed you that we have marked something like this. So there are three techniques. In certain practices, it is preferred that the clamp that was placed is placed on the tooth first, followed by the sheet. In certain practices, the practitioners place the rubber dam sheet over the tooth first and the assistants help them with the clamp. You can see this. This is so clear, but it can be cumbersome for my practice. I believe if I am doing it, I should be able to do it single-handedly, or just in case I am lower on the human resource and my assistant is busy with arranging other stuff for my practice and my patient. So what I'll do is I will choose the clamp, followed by, it is always suggested that these clamps should be very sturdy. You should be knowing about the health of these clamps. If these clamps are not healthy, that means they have been used very frequently and over the years you have not changed your clamps, because they are available as accessories from the different brands. If you don't change them, there is a possibility that they might break away during the placement onto the tooth. It can be very hurtful to the patient and to the dentist itself. So with this clamp holder, I am just trying to check if the clamp or this retainer fits well. So how do you check? In the patient itself, if you have anesthetized the patient properly, it is highly recommended that the tooth should be completely anesthetized before you start with your rubber dam, because these prongs place a lot of forces onto the gingiva and it can be hurtful to the patient. So I just tried this clamp and we have to see the mobility. If it is not removing or it is not jumping out of the tooth, this will work properly for my single tooth isolation. So after checking it, in certain practices we have seen that Vaseline can be coated, petroleum jelly that can be coated onto the area of punched hole. Few people say that this petroleum jelly can cause a bit of deterioration to these sheets, but so far I have not experienced such certain deterioration in sheet consistency. So please look carefully what I am doing with the clamp and the sheet. This is a technique that is very, very useful. So what I am doing is, if you see from here, my sheet will actually come here and the orientation of my ring of the clamp should be on the back side, that means towards the second molar. So I am orienting my sheet and I place one wing and I stretch over the other side and just place it this way. So it becomes very easy. we can now use our clamp forceps and you can engage it, you can tighten it up so that you don't lose the grip of the product, the clamp. Can you see there is a small dot onto the surface of the molar? This is for a visual guide. Can you see this? If I lose the track of the tooth while taking my clamp inside the mouth and the tooth is not marked, there is a possibility that I can shift my orientation and I place my clamp over the posterior teeth or maybe the much more anterior teeth of the concern. So marking of the tooth is important. This is a model, we have placed a small dot with the pen, but in clinical cases rubber dam or gingiva, the small gingival barrier can be used. This is a small blue dot. If it is placed, it does not harm the tooth at all and your orientation will be over. So while placing this, you can see there is still some dam that is over the wings. So what I will do, I will engage with a blunt instrument, the blunt side of the instrument, and I will directly place it, and this is the placement of your clamp and the rubber dam. After this, what is done, it is usually preferred to use a floss and move it from the lingual side to the buccal side and move on this side. Place it and move it. So what it does, it places your gingival sheet much more deeper into the embrasure area and make sure that there is no leakage of saliva. You can go on the posterior side also and the distal surface is also checked. What we can do is, after this is done in the patient, you can place your frame. So there are two techniques of placing the frame. One is beneath the dam, or what I prefer is I usually place my frame over the dam. So there are certain advantages I have learned while using this frame over the dam. What usually happens is we are working in with aerators and lot of moisture is there. So what I do is I hold this part of the dam and using the stretchability I do this. So any liquid that is dropping stays here like a pocket, small pocket. My assistant is very happy with this because we can use the suction here and take out all the liquid that has come out during the excess cavity preparation or if any irrigation material is dropping or dripping outside. Apart from it, the advantage is there is no liquid that goes onto the patient's drape or their clothes. So it is a very helpful method I have learned during my post-graduation days. I would like to tell you how to use a gingival sheet, the gingival dam or liquid dam, because what happens is we have seen in many cases that certain amount of leakage is possible in this embrasure area. So what happens is if you place your liquid dam like this, it provides a certain amount of surety that there is no liquid that will drip out of the excess cavity. In certain cases when there is no distal or mesial wall in a tooth and it needs a single visit restoration or a single visit endodontic treatment, this liquid dam acts like a temporary wall and it helps us in maintaining the isolation. Let's do this for a maxillary tooth also. Let's see how it will work. I will try to show you another technique just in case you don't have a template like this and you are missing out on a template, or you believe that your suction should happen from the dam also. Apart from it, you want to do intraoral suction. So there is a very easy technique we use every time, and this is a second technique. Please see it very carefully. I'll use the floss again. Make sure that there is enough space. And my floss goes very well. If this is the buccal surface and this is the palatal surface, this side of the clamp will be used on the buccal surface. I'll mark another sheet. So this is the shiny surface and this is the matte finish. So this will be towards the occlusal surface of the tooth and this will be towards the gingiva. So we are marking just in between. We are taking one single dot here and we are marking the sheet. What I will do is I usually place it like this because these top ends should not be let loose and this area we can use it as a pocket. So I prefer going stretching one end and a diagonally opposite end of the sheet. This way frame is ready to work. Mostly what happens with this stainless steel form is they are kind of very sharp. So while you are learning to place the sheet, there is a high possibility to tear your sheet. So in my practice, they are seldomly used, or my associates use them because of their convenience. But for all restorative procedures and for endodontic procedures, I prefer this radiolucent frame. There is a complete frame also that covers the maxillary part or the upper lip, that is Nyagard Ossby kind of frame. A new development has been done. There is a flexible frame. There is a hinge here on this part, so it is very easy to use it, and you can take intraoral radiographs. That is very frequently used by endodontists. So what we are doing, we have a small dot here. We forgot to place the orientation dot. This is helpful while we are removing something or we need to place our same rubber dam again. So this dot helps us massively. So what I am doing is, I am taking this, and as you all know, the maxillary molar is the biggest in size. So I'll take the biggest punch hole, and I'll go along with this way and punch a hole here. I told you guys, I take 1.5 size. I've seen certain practitioners use the Mickey Mouse rule, that they make 3 small holes with the same kind of diameter. So that's a Mickey Mouse design. But I usually don't do it. It is not, I have not learned it that way. That's why I'm not using it. I have no evidence to say that technique is wrong. I have no evidence, but I'm using it in my preferred way. So let us imagine that this is the case and this is a tooth. So this is on the first quadrant and this is the buccal surface. Please imagine this way, that this is a tooth and this is the tooth of concern with buccal surface on this side. So my instruments will go like this. My instruments will go like this and removal will happen like this only. This will be on the distal surface of the tooth. So this is, when you place this entire assembly, it will come like this. You can see I have hidden the clamp wings, and this anterior wings they are up, but these lower, the posterior wings are hidden with the clamp, and the entire assembly will go. If the tooth is like this, the entire assembly will go together. I'll show you how I will place it. Let's see. The tooth is here. I'll change the model because there is some sort of misunderstanding with that model. I am not comfortable right now. So this is the second molar of the first molar of the second quadrant. So this becomes easy. The ring of the clamp is on the distal surface of the concerned tooth. The sheet is already placed and it becomes so easy to isolate a single teeth with this technique. A simple floss will work and it will make sure that there is nothing that is hindering. As we have placed the floss, you should not move palatally, you should move buccally. I wish to show you one more thing. There is a product called as Vegex. They come from hygienic company, basically dealt with by Colteen in India. So these are small rubber tubes. What happens is there are certain times when interdental distance of the tooth is huge, or we can say that certain teeth have big areas or big embrasure areas. So these rubber widgets go in between and they can hold on to the surface. You can see there is a big embrasure area here. So if you try to place a rubber dam here, there is a huge possibility that you can actually your clamp will slip off very frequently, or your rubber dam sheet does not stay there. So these widgets actually go interdental and make sure that your sheet is staying there. So this is a very useful product from the company. In case you don't buy this or you run out of this, there is another indigenous way of getting interdental areas properly covered. You can cut a small corner of the rubber dam sheet that you are using, and this sheet can go inside and stay there. So this also gives you a good hold of single tooth isolation. For multiple tooth isolation, we will be learning more about how to do multiple teeth, and in case mostly anterior teeth that are done for restoration, class 4 restorations and class 3 restorations, and your post and core work. And for this multiple restorations if required, or the tooth is highly damaged and you want to place, there is no place to retain a clamp, then what happens is we have to use the help or take the help of the posterior teeth that is available and place your clamp here, followed by the isolation. So this multiple teeth isolation will be part of the next video. From the next part of this video is anterior teeth. I will teach you how to isolate anterior teeth also. In a similar manner, when these anterior teeth have to be isolated, please make sure that you are using the right kind of clamp and you are placing them properly. The clamp with limited space, you can see very short area, these are used for lower anteriors and lateral incisors of the maxilla. The bigger clamps, they are used for anterior. I'll show you just with the clamp how to place your clamps properly. following this surface, this has to be on the buccal surface of the tooth. So in this case, your dam, your retainer will come like this. For restorative purposes, when you are doing laminates, you are doing veneers, it will help this way. Just reverse it again and the same clamp will help you in gaining more space on the palatal surface of the tooth. It is placed here and palatally it will help you. So there will be more space for you to work on the access openings here. Similarly, on the lower anterior teeth, you can place your clamp like this for endodontic purpose and for restorative purpose. It will give you a good grip. There is another purpose of the same clamp. They fit very well onto the premolars also. So, second premolar and first premolar, just in case there is lot of tooth destruction or a class 2 cavity was placed and your premolar clamp is not fitting well, you can use the same clamp for wider approach. It gives you a better area for a rotator to work, and for your instruments the convenience form is very high. I'll show you how to use a premolar clamp also. The orientation has to be the same way. The ring has to be on the posterior surface of the tooth and placement has to be proper. When you place a clamp, always try to shake it. If it is frequently shaking, that means it has to be changed or you need to check for another clamp. As we all know how to floss our endodontic files for sterilization purposes and for making sure that you don't lose them while there are no iatrogenic errors that are happening and it does not go through the down the throat of the patient. For safety purposes, the clamps, while we are trying them into the patient's mouth or when you are using them, being brittle in nature, they are slightly flexible, but the kind of nature stainless steel has, it becomes brittle at a certain point of time or they become aged. So what happens is there is a possibility that they break away. It is suggested that you should also floss them. I'll show you how to floss a clamp. This is the technique. I have been very practiced with, or I can say I've been using this technique for a very long time. That's why it is in my hands and I prefer this technique. But you can develop your own technique for flossing the clamp. you can see I am tying the entire clamp, because if it fractures, it will fracture. The weakest point is this ring. So in case a clamp fractures, it will fracture from the middle part of the ring. And I have tied both sides, and this part of the floss that is going, that is loose, should be placed on the side. That if we place this clamp, so it should be on the buckle side. Similarly, if this is placed on this tooth, it will go buckle. So this, the loose end should be on the buckle side of the clamp. There is one more thing that is very famous nowadays due to restorative procedures and good amount of work that rubber dam has been accepted widely now, and it has become a basic norm during this difficult times of COVID. It has become a basic norm to use a rubber dam in all the situations. I am teaching you how to make a floss tie. So take a floss tie, take a piece of floss and it becomes like a small piece of floss. This, when used on a tooth surface, consider that there is a sheet and you want to go much more deep gingival, then this kind of floss tie is done, and you just track it like this, and there is complete retraction of the gingiva and the rubber dam together. There can be certain difficult times when you do not know how to go with the rubber dam and it is not going in the gingival sulcus. There is no retraction or reversion. We say there is a term called as reverting the rubber dam sheet. That means the rubber dam sheet should this part of the ring, part of the rubber dam, should be towards the gingiva. It should go like this within the gingival sulcus. So in case this reversion is not happening in your case, using a floss tie is a good effective method. It can be used very frequently. That is all for today. I believe I was able to cover most part of the rubber dam for today's session. There are many more technical things that can be added to rubber dam techniques, but learning rubber dam in an easier way is much more necessary in my personal opinion. It's a priority for the module for all my participants. So let's do learn rubber dam more frequently. Let's do it quickly. I would ask you, if you have not bought it till now, or your practice has a rubber dam kit but it has not been used for a very long time, please start using it. I am always available for more information on the rubber dams. Let's learn it very quickly. I will meet you again in the next video for multiple isolation of the teeth. It will be for anterior teeth and for posterior teeth. I'll teach you both techniques. Let's meet again. Till then, bye for now and happy learning. Because of your participation, virtual training program is taking a lot of gaining space in the virtual world, and the YouTube channel and the Facebook part is coming up very good. Thank you for all the support and trusting the program. Bye for now and take care.